sat there and watched him for a minute. I went back down there, man, you sure you don't want to play? Like, nah, I just wanted to. Basically, he was there to get some things off his mind. So
yeah.
I got in my car, man, at that time. I just bought me a Benz, you know, I was getting the car. That's when they had the flip phones. I called my cousin, man, I just beat Michael Jordan one-on-one tonight. Yeah, he didn't want to play again. You know, we didn't play, and then come to find out, that's what, during the time when he was going through the issues with his father. Yeah. So apparently he had been going to the gym, just getting stuff off his mind. And that was my first time meeting him. So that was like one of the biggest moments, because I was waiting for that. Me and Nick used to argue all the time. I thought Magic Johnson was the best player. He thought, coming from Kenosha, he thought Wisconsin, Michael Jordan was the best player. He ended up getting drafted to the Lakers, and I ended up getting drafted to Chicago. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was just an honor at that time to finally meet him and hear, man, I met Scotty. So that was probably the best moment for me, man, is finally knowing that I was there, man. After that, it was just a job and going to play and competing and things I'd already done.
So what would, I mean, in 11 seasons, I mean, you didn't just, I mean, play a couple years. I mean, you were in the NBA 11 seasons.
Right.
I mean, that's, I mean, that right there is extremely
committed. Well, yeah, you know, I'm famous for one thing. I played with Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen, Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant, and not won a damn championship ring.
Man. And you know, it's interesting. We were talking about this before the show, Eddie. The year after he left, everybody started winning.
Yeah, man.
Because think about it. Like, he left the Bulls in 95. They won 96, 97, 98.
Right.
I mean, he left the Lakers in 99. Then, they won three after that.
Yeah.
And so it's like, really, what put them between winning was him. It was his fault. He was the cause. Once they got rid of Corey Blunt, they started winning championships. Everybody started three-peating after Corey.
Bro,
I'm scared to drive
Chicago,
home now because Corey's
myself.
On my show.
No, I didn't have to leave. They begged me to stay.
Like I said, I'm scared to drive home because I've been on the show with Corey, but I'm going home with some hardware now.
Hey, now, something happened to you, I won't be feeling bad.
It's your
man.
Fault. You already know. It's the Corey jinx. That's a new little dance called
what
the Corey jinx.
What happened to the jinxes in college and in junior college?
Oh, yeah. And by the way, it was 19.5 points. It wasn't 20.
In JUCO?
Yeah, it was 19.5 points you averaged. Yeah, I was fine. Anything else?
Let them live, man. Let them cook.
Well, I mean, you can't argue stats.
No.
You can't argue that.
No, that was a heck of a career.
You're around 19,
I mean, no, you can't.
I mean, you usually
you're right. My bad. I said I'm like,
what school did you go to?
I ain't go to school, man. I went to Hard Knocks, bro.
Junior college.
I went to Hard Knocks. And what I can say is I went to the Mac school, and we beat LSU when I was in college. Yeah. We beat LSU at LSU 21-12. But so I'm like, yeah, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, but that's, I mean, that, yeah, man, I mean, literally, I mean, it's certainly a pleasure, you know, I mean, to have you here, and, man, to be able to kick it with you.
After 20 years, I mean, I've been seeing this dude all around.
Whatever.
He ain't never said, man, you don't come on my show, so it took me to
Because all I knew is he couldn't play pool, so, you know, I used to beat him like a stepchild on the pool table.
Bring that rigged stick to my
hold on, hold on, I used to beat you like a redheaded stepchild.
Used to come in and go out by itself, you know, it had some kind of little pogo device. I'm like, man, where'd you get that? My stick, man.
Hey, it is what it is, yo. It's like, yo, you know what I'm saying?
Scope on there and everything.
Of course, like, you got to come prepared, man.
Sound like a husband.
Yeah.
So, Eddie, what's up next with the sports fan? I mean, we know you've got the blog, a great blog, EddieTheSportsFan.com. What's going next in your world, man?
Yeah, you know, we've done EddieTheSportsFan.com for about 3.5 years now. November 11th, 2011, 11-11-11. Say that three times fast. Don't do it. I'm just joking. We're launching TheSportsFanJournal.com. TheSportsFanJournal.com is something that I've been working on and praying on for about a year or so now. You see other online publications like Grantland.com, which is owned by Bill Simmons and ESPN. You see the Huffington Post, Deadspin. You see certain blogs that, you know, I'm pretty sure if this man was in the league right now, he'd probably hate blogs to a certain degree because you hear about,
critical. You
know, tawdry news and salacious details that come out and rumors. And let me tell you something right now. You're never going to see anything I ever post. You're not going to see any Wang pics. Can I say Wang pics? Okay. You ain't gonna see any of those. You're not gonna see any basketball-wise stuff or anything. I don't condone that type of behavior personally. What you are gonna see is you're gonna see hard-hitting commentary. You're gonna see original, thought-provoking content. We wanna make you laugh. We wanna make you cry. Because we look at sports like the ultimate reality television show. I mean, you see comedy, action, horror, sci-fi, anything that
Chris
appeals
Johnson.
To your senses.
Chris Johnson.
You know, it's
Jamarcus Russell.
Well. You can see the Chris Johnson stopwatch. I mean, you've seen the stopwatch before, right? The stopwatch chain?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the diamond-encrusted platinum chain with his 42440 time on it? you haven't seen this, you need to Google this as soon as you get home. Yeah, so, you know, everybody knows Chris Johnson. He ran the 4.24 40, got him drafted in the first round out of East Carolina in 2008. Well, he said, you know what, I'm going to, you know, commemorate running the 4.24. And so he got a stopwatch chain pendant made with the 4.24. Oh, yeah, boss hog.
Doing it big.
Now, you know, now he held out for that money. Now that spin move looking kind of slow. He ran out of turbo. And he averaged 2.9 yards a carry. It's not looking good in Tennessee.
But. And they showed him break. They broke his film down to show where he's missing everything. Yeah. That it's not his blocking. It's him. He's missing lanes everywhere. And
how do you go from that? How can you physically explain?
They said it's a Sean Alexander syndrome. That you sign a big contract and your inspiration and your motivation goes.
So he's not working.
They're saying that's what they're believing it is. Is that Sean Alexander, 1,880 yards the year before he signed a big contract, the next 3 years he didn't total 1,800 yards. Mm-hmm. And so you look at Chris Johnson, now 2.9 yards a carry, hadn't had over 50 yards in the game, and he signs a big contract. And I think it's the same thing with Jamarcus Russell. You give him $13 million, what did he get, $11 million signing bonus up front, and he's a 290-pound quarterback. Has all the skills. Now, I tell people I'm having faith in Jamarcus Russell because I've seen the games and the several games that where he's been exemplary. And so I think that he still has the opportunity and potential. He's going back to LSU in the spring for school, and he's also going to be training. But he's 26 years old. So I think that part of it is that, you know, that I think people just get comfortable. And I think that's a struggle for a lot
everybody
of
people. Everybody don't handle success. Look at it like that. I've arrived. What do I need to work hard for?
And that's unfortunate because, you know, when I look at, you know, my nephew and, you know, Devin over with me, this kid works harder than any kid. When I look at Kelsey Mitchell over at Princeton, she's the number one sophomore in the country, high school basketball. When I look at her and I look at the work ethic that she has, and I look at the motor that she puts into it, and I think that the biggest misnomer in professional sports is God-given talent. That's the biggest misnomer. And even professional athletes will say when they're commentating, I'll hear Sapp say it, or I'll hear Deion say it, or Michael Irvin, we've been given this talent. No, you worked. You've been conditioning and working your body since you were four. And so to me, it's just a misnomer that when I look at what Devin, she puts up 1,000 shots a day, and then he'll go to basketball practice. Then after basketball practice, he'll go to personal training. You don't become great by not doing it. But nobody's going to see that. All they're going to see is when he graduates and ends up in college. Let's give 30 seconds, both of you, before we have to wrap this up. 30 seconds.
I just want to say look out for graduate apparel. I'm really going to be trying to put this out there to the public around graduation time, man. We're just trying to influence these kids and reward the ones who get it done, man. That's what life's all about, just to graduate and be real proud of your accomplishments. So that's what it's all about with me, just trying to promote graduate awareness here.
Eddie?
Well, first off, thank you again for having me on the show. I'm greatly appreciative. Be sure to give me a follow on Twitter at edthesportsfan.com. Excuse me, at edthesportsfan. Check out the website, edthesportsfan.com. We're doing great things, and we're going to do bigger and better each and every day.
Thank you. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us this evening on the Genesis Men's Hour. we'd like to thank them. We've had a lot of fun.
Be back.
And remember, this is a live call-in show. Really thank all of you that have been watching us over the last 15, 16 years. I'd like to thank Roger Horton for producing the show and all of those people that go to contain and continue the efforts of the Media Bridges. So I definitely want to give a shout out to all the donors here and all the work and the effort it takes to produce these shows. And sometimes a little wild and crazy, but we enjoy them. But again, my name is Wendell Ellis. I've enjoyed being in your homes this evening. This is the Genesis Men's Hour. Have a beautiful evening and a safe Halloween weekend. And we will see you next month around Thanksgiving. And remember, we're going to have a Genesis Fellowship reunion December, early January. Have a good one. Thank you.
I get to come to that, right?
Yeah, man, I don't know about it, not yet.
Shows I got to do.
Man, you got to do something after.
Don't sweat the technique. Get filed.
now, it'll take a while. I change the pace to complete the beat. I drop the bass to MCs get weak. For every road they trace, it's a scar they keep. It's when I speak, they freak and sweat the technique. I made my debut in 86 with a melody in a president's mix. And I would stay on target and refuse to miss. And I still make hits for beats. Parties, clubs, and cars and jeeps. My underground sound vibrates the streets. MCs wanna be, then I play for keeps. When they sweat the technique. Wondering what's next. Pieces took the last to observe them. They couldn't absorb them. They didn't.